We take all of them into grade 8 and then support them through 8, 9th and 10th. So we run the school, we appoint our own principals, we appoint our own teachers, our counselors, everything about the pedagogy, the timing, all of that is run by iTeach. We don't charge any fees from students. The schools are completely free for the students. And then the student alumni wing kicks in after grade 10 to support them for 5 more years until they finish college. So our first point of our student vision statement is to and through college. And the 8th, 9th and 10th help students get to college. And then the student alumni wing helps them stay through college and finish that all the way to employment. We started 4 years ago. April 30th will mark 4 years of our completion. We started with 2 schools back in 2015 and have scaled to 6 schools across Pune city right now. We serve about 1,200 students, about 350 alum, and with a staff, full-time staff of about 125 people now. This includes the principals, the vice principals, the administrative staff, our network team, our curriculum team, recruitment team, and myself. What I do personally, I spend half my time these days coaching the school leaders and the other half overseeing operations of recruitment, fundraising, government relations, other things like that. About 2 years ago, we got, as our first batch was finishing grade 10, something that we knew very deeply inside was that just getting them to grade 10, no matter how strongly, was not going to be enough to put them on a fundamentally different life path. The goal of iTeach is to make sure that our students are on a fundamentally different life trajectory than what our society has set out for them, right? Society wants the students from the poorest schools to go to government schools. The government schools in Pune are among the worst schools in the city. And then drop out at grade 7 and not make it through college and not make it to aspirational jobs and careers that all middle-income and high-income students want. And iTeach fundamentally wants to wage war on this status quo. And the 3 years that they have with us in grade 8, 9th, and 10th was not going to be enough to achieve this. And that's where we founded the student alumni wing to say, how can we continue supporting them for 5 more years after grade 10 to make sure they genuinely get through college and to the first employment level at least, where then we are more sure about backing away our support over time. And that's kind of the main purpose of starting the student alumni wing. I'm going to start my screen share now. And Ekta, once you can see my screen, just tell me that that's on, yeah?
Yeah, we'll do that.
Okay.
Yeah, I can see your screen.
Awesome. So one thing to kind of set the boundary of this webinar is that I'm very specifically focused on how are we supporting students after they graduate away from our schools and are studying in about 60 colleges across the city now. Just to kind of build context really quickly, 2 batches of our students have graduated. 100% of our students have graduated in the last 2 years. Our results have been significantly better than comparable low-income schools. And our students are very much in mainstream junior colleges across the city in grades 11th and 12th right now. 95% of them are pursuing mainstream 11th and 12th. About 5% are either in vocational courses or in diploma courses. And we're pushing really hard to make sure not a single one of our 350 alum who graduated drop out during these years for any reason possible. And so I'm focusing this webinar a lot on the student alumni wing and how do we continue supporting students after they've graduated from schools and are in colleges. At the same time, I'm very happy to share insights that we've gleaned in the last 4 years on running schools for secondary students, specifically taking students only after 7 years they've already done in a government school and they're coming to us only in grade 8, 9th and 10th. But that's not the core focus area of this webinar. So what I'd encourage you guys to do, if you have questions about the school itself, to park them for now. And I'm happy to use some of the Q&A time to answer questions about the school. But during the webinar itself, let's focus on how are we supporting them after school and making sure that they get through college. Yeah. The second really interesting thing we're going to try to do today is that I'm actually leading about half of this webinar, which is going to talk about the why and the what of student alumni wing, but all of the how. So how does the student alumni wing actually implement it? I have three of our alums here, Mahesh, Sana, and Snehal, who are all grade 11 students right now. They just gave their grade 11 exams. Hopefully they're going to pass. They're sitting in front of me and smiling and making fun of me. But hopefully they're going to make it through to grade 12. But they're going to share a lot of the work that how we translate this vision into on-the-ground projects and also what are they doing to help us during it. So that's really the exciting part. Yeah, the first 30 minutes where I'm churning through the what and the why is a little boring. But just bear with me because the real stars are coming in another 30 minutes from now. Yeah? Okay, no pressure, guys. Let's jump in, yeah? Three main parts of this webinar. First one, what are the barriers that low-income students face post-school? Second one, what are some enablers? What are some key levers to help them get through college? And the third one, which is what my students are going to run through, is what has iTeach been doing to try and address this and create this continuum of support, yeah? I'll also tell you all you guys that actually this wing was founded and is led by Tanvi Metre. She's the leader of the student alumni wing. She's unfortunately on a flight back from the US. She's actually in the US studying great schools and alumni programs in the US over the last week. And so I'm a substitute teacher, okay? So if I don't have depth in some of the things and I can't answer questions, just know that message substitute kar raha hu uske liye. To wo baad mein, isliye maine email address bhi Tanvi Metre ka diya hai. Aap unko puchega, theek hai? In-depth questions. You know how things are, right? When you become CEO, your depth of understanding in each of your programs really reduces. So just bear with me if I'm not as thorough as she is in some of these things. Okay, I'm going to run through this vision a little bit and then I'm going to pause for a second and let Ekta or anyone else have any questions around the why itself, okay? That's the vision that we started with about 2 years ago now, that we want to create an alumni-driven community of support to ensure that all the alumni are proactively taking steps towards an employment. Really, we're focused on the employment, aligned to their personal vision, rooted in respect and rooted in respect for self and others. And three proof points that we really want to drive towards that tell us the vision is coming alive. We want 100% of our students to finish grade 12, 100% of them to finish graduation, and 100% to be on the path to employment that aligns with what they really want to do. I'll share a couple of things and I'll open it up to questions for a little bit, yeah? The first really important thing here is 100, 100, 100. And just to kind of make this clear, I'm not saying that the colleges in India are fantastic, okay? I've done all my college education in India also. At the same time, what we firmly believe is that any middle income and high income student today, the minimum bar that their parents and their school expects them to achieve is a college graduation degree. And without a college graduation, no matter what skills you have, you really hit a glass ceiling extremely quickly. And we don't want any of our students to hit that. And I'm also not saying that college is the place where they learn the most things, but it gives them enough time to develop socially, emotionally, learn from their peers, generate enough self-awareness so that post-college they can step into whatever is their vision and kind of, you know, pursue those things, which is why we're very keen that every single student finishes graduation. And that only happens if you finish grade 12. Employment also really important because we know the families that our students come from. And it's really important. One of the main goals of our students, even if you talk to them, is that they want to lift their family out of poverty, right? And so employment is something key to them. Employment could be self-employment. Yeah, it doesn't have to be employment in a job, but it could be entrepreneurship as well. But these are some of our focus areas that we've decided as non-negotiables and we've been driving towards really hard in the last 2 years. The second really important thing for us is the alumni-driven community of support. So what that means is that over time, we'd like our alum to be driving this entire wing. And when you hear from Mahesh, Sana, and Snehal, you'll also hear from them that what is the role that they're playing in the student alumni wing. So we have a 7-member student alumni wing, 7 full-time staff employed by iTeach, and 15 alumni leaders, these three being part of that group. And together, this 22-member team supports our 350 alum. over time, what we want is that these alum take the lead and drive a community of support such that all our alum are able to achieve these three proof points. And the student alumni wing can start backing out slowly over time through it. That's kind of the vision and three proof points. And I'm going to stop speaking for a bit now. And either, Ekta, if you have some questions or somebody else who wants to ask questions, just jump in, yeah?
Yeah, I had three questions in the chat window.
Perfect.
One was Sundar, who's asking that why is education mapped to employment? And can't we include local skills in the curriculum?
Sorry, can't we include what? What's the second part?
Why can't we include local skills in the curriculum?
So, I'm not clear what local skills mean.
Yeah, but I think Sundar can clarify that as well.
Yeah. Sundar, go for it.
Hello, Soumya.
Hi, Sundar. Yes.
Hi. So, what exactly I mean by local skills is like agriculture or the local skills like pottery, bamboo crafts and all those things that can easily give them a livelihood option rather than just going into one kind of livelihood option that our education system provides them.
Fair. So, I'm not saying that they have to all go into the same kind of option. I'm saying that what college degree is really important to get the time to explore networks, to get the time to explore the education. In parallel, please go ahead and pursue what your passion is. So as an example, there are a couple of students who are pursuing beautician courses right now because they're very passionate about it. But what we're encouraging you to do is do your college graduation in addition to pursuing your beautician course. So they might very well be running their own beauty parlors and stuff. But please complete the graduation on the side as well. Similarly, there's Mahesh can talk about this when he gets on line here. His genuine real passion lies in theater and performing arts. And so what Mahesh is doing is he's part of a group called Umang, where he spends, I think, more than 4 to 5 hours a day pursuing his passion for performing arts and actually converting it into a livelihood option over time. At the same time, we're encouraging him to make sure that he continues to go through college as well. So it's very much an and game in our mind right now.
Sundar, I hope that answers your question. Maybe if you had more questions, then probably do use the chat window. In the meantime, Soumya, there's a question by Kushali, and she's asking, does iTeach open school at various locations in Pune or use government school infrastructure for it?
iTeach runs the schools within the government schools itself. So unfortunately, the enrollment from public schools is dropping heavily in cities. In Pune, it's at 80-20 already. 80% students already go to private school. Only 20% are going to government school. This has led to multiple government buildings being empty right now. So iTeach is a PPP model where the contribution from the public, which is the government, is the building. The private contribution is all the funds that we get from CSR and philanthropy, which enables us to pay salaries and buy all the equipment and stuff like that. And so, yeah, we use government space, but it's a completely independent school within that government space. We just take the space from them. We run it in 6 schools right now across the city. If you go to our website, itschools.org, it tells you more about the PPP model and also tells you where these 6 schools are.
So I'll save the link in the chat window as well in the meantime.
Thanks.
Monica had a question that do you take students only from Pune city at the moment or other cities as well?
Only from Pune city, Monica. Pune city has 54 primary English medium schools right now. When I say primary, it means that they go until grade 7. And currently, we are only able to cater to about 10 of them. So our vision for 2025, at least for the next 5 to 6 years, is first give access and quality to as many students in Pune as possible before spreading out of Pune city.
I think that answers the next question by somebody whose name is Admin here. So that it's only in Pune city at the moment. Nimisha has a question that what kind of CSR do you conduct? Could you shed some light on the philanthropy aspect of it as well?
What do you mean by what kind of CSR do we conduct? So each of our schools takes approximately 40,000 rupees per student per year to operate. The funds for these schools, essentially, our org budget is around 6 crores right now per year. And the funds, these 6 crores, come from grants from foundations, from CSR from companies and from some philanthropy from high net worth individuals. That's what I meant about CSR. As in, government doesn't give us funds and we don't charge from students. All of our org is supported by either foundations, HNIs, or CSR. Our website also calls out all our funding partners. So if you're curious about some of that, that's also on our website. Our website also has an annual report. So if you pull that down, it has a lot of details about our program, how we do it, who are our donors, and all of that.
Soumya, those are the only questions I got in the chat window. But if there's anybody else who wants to voice their questions, feel free to do that.
Fantastic. I'm going to use 30 seconds to do a little bit of my agenda, okay? While we're talking about the org, et cetera, we also have open positions. I have a specific school leader position open and a couple of lead teacher positions open. Go to the website, check out the careers page and ping me if you're interested. Okay, back to the webinar, yeah? So this is why we exist, okay? Let's move to what are the key barriers that they face. So about a year and a half ago, when we jumped into starting this wing, our team spent time visiting all the 40 odd colleges where our alumni were placed. We conducted in-depth one-on-one interviews with 65% of our students, and also talked to a lot of focus groups of students, not just ours, but also from other low-income schools, students who were in college. We also informed our program through two really well-known organizations. One is called KIPP, which is a network of about 200 schools in the US with pretty stellar results of taking students from low-income communities and getting them to college. And One Goal, which is an organization in Chicago, which also does some really fantastic work. The reason I'm putting this information out there is if you want to go and read more about this, these are two specific orgs that have informed a lot of our program design in the last 2 years or so. Collecting all of this, we summarized the major five barriers as the ones on the screen. I'll go over them in about 2 minutes and then I'll pause again to allow you guys to read through it and ask me questions. So the first one is, our students are fighting a very lonely battle. Yeah. One of the side effects of being a first generation learner is that while they're in school or while they're in college, they have a certain ecosystem around them where there are high expectations and where there are academics and where there are peer learning, etc. As soon as they move out of that, Mahesh is very alone at home, where he's not sure who to talk to. He's not sure who a role model in his community is. He doesn't know what are the best colleges going ahead. In fact, you can always think of the difference, you know, jab hamare ghar hota hai, in our houses, India Today ki wo magazine aati thi. I don't know, aapke ghar mein aati thi, mere ghar mein to aati thi, and my father used to run me through it from 6th standard only, top colleges in India, no matter koi branch ka ho, right? Of course, I was a reasonably strong student, plus my father was an engineer. So, meri to pehle hi katha likhi hui thi ki tumko engineering karna hai and JEE ki taiyari karni hai, to maine kiya. But you would know what great colleges are, whether in the city or in India, even when you were in fourth and fifth standard. That's just not the case with our students, you know. And so there's no clarity on what am I driving towards. And also a really key thing is expectations, right? Hamare se expectations the ki aapko top college mein jana hai. These expectations are just not there from our students. So that is the biggest thing that we found missing for our students. The academic one, I'm just going to stop. I don't want to describe too much, but even with 3 years of strong intervention from our schools, our students are still walking in vastly underprepared into college. The third one is financial readiness. How do they pay for some of the colleges that they're getting into? The fourth one is many of them want to do part-time jobs and internships and things, but they're not sure how to go about it. Same thing with rigorous hobbies. Rigorous hobbies means that Mahesh, for example, loves theater, but he doesn't know how to go about and join a great theater group. If somebody wants a part-time job, they don't know how to write a CV. They don't know how to interview. They don't even know how to go apply. What are the opportunities available? And the last one is more at a mindset level. I feel like in school, the school really spoon feeds you a lot. When you go to college, you're like, damn, I have to figure all this out on my own. As well as for many of our girls, the pressure to get married, and many of our students, the pressure to start working soon. So these are the five, I've summarized a lot of Tanvi's data into these five big buckets of gaps that we have, that we found that were facing our students. I'm going to stop here again for a minute or two, let you guys just absorb these five big barriers and then ask questions around it. And then we'll move into what do we think are enablers.
Soumya, I had two questions to what you just mentioned. Yes. I was curious to know a little bit about, which I think earlier there was a question as well, that you're working in an urban context, right?
Yes.
And also there are students who are coming, first generation students who are coming with a rural context. There are a lot of those things I'm sure that are happening, which you might know as well. I'm just trying to understand from a cultural perspective to students who've never been thinking about at least the literature on Dalit students, for example, right? Your self-esteem is questioned.
Ekta, can you be a little louder, please?
Can you hear me now? Is it better?
Yeah.
So, for example, I was thinking when you say first-generation learners, the first thing that comes to my mind is Dalit students, where self-esteem and things like these, which are, of course, a problem for the other students as well. But for Dalit students, say it's a definite concern, right? Because cultural, all of these are things that something that they grow up questioning. And I was wondering, how do you address this idea of self-esteem as well? And also make them feel, you know, that whatever their cultural contribution is, whatever their context is, as much valuable as other things as well.
Yeah. So when we get to how, you'll see some of the ways we are doing it. Very honestly, though, what we found, Ekta, this is specific to our students a little bit, is they didn't face many of these things. We were also very worried how they would adjust when they walk into a Ferguson college. What I found was 3 to 4 months in, they were able to figure this stuff out. And they have something called a through college advisor. And when we get to that, you know, in the how, maybe some of these students can share what their, even now, guys, if you want to share something around this, how did you find yourself fitting into college? Just go and just add, but what we found that within 3-4 months with this advisor, somebody to talk to, they were able to bridge that self-esteem, self-confidence gap reasonably quickly. And we also do a lot of work on that in school, honestly, where we'll do a college field trip, for example. In grade 10, the day they get into grade 10, we'll do a full-day college field trip where they're familiar with what does college look like and what is in store there. We'll push them in as many opportunities as possible where they go and interact with students from high-income schools and middle-income schools, from Model United Nations to Kids Education Revolution, from conferences to sports events, so that they don't feel that. And also they have, we'll do a lot of work on their own storytelling also, so that they're walking in knowing, self-aware, what is... So honestly, what I've found, Ekta, is most of our students are walking in confident saying, I have got here on my mehnat from a far lower support system level than most of the people here. So confidence to mera two times hona chahiye, because the amount of effort I have put in to get here is phenomenally higher than what Soumya Bhaiya, for example, had to put in. Yeah. And so 3-4 mahina lagta hai as part of onboarding, but it generally seems to have worked out reasonably well, and our fears were slightly unfounded. Do you guys want to add something related to this? How did you blend into college? Either of you two? Yeah? Okay.
Hello, I'm Sana.
Hi, Sana.
I'm a grade student in Don Bosco College, currently studying there. Like what Soumya said, definitely we were really confident because we got out from there. We got a lot of support from teachers, parents, because they were so involved with us. But later, I think something maybe I did not cope up well was because of the culture in the college. People are already very hi-fi. They know that after college they have to go out for a coffee, come together. But for me it was a little bit odd because teachers used to say that in the college it was not allowed because they said boys and girls can't roam out alone after the college. But these guys did, and they definitely asked me to. Once when I went out with them, they did ask me for smoking and all. This came out very different for me. where am I? Am I at the right place? Am I in the good company? Because when I was in school, I was definitely in a good company where people, we always kept discussing about studies and all. Suddenly a change where people are asking me for smoke, definitely it influences me. Coming back home with this thought that if my mother gets to know that I'm living in such a space, will she allow me to go to college again? Or will she be okay with sending in this college? Or will she drop the idea of me studying ahead? But like Bhaiya said, having an advisor who would always be there to tell you what is right and wrong did really help me. To tell me that, look, that's okay. You're jumping in an ocean. You are going to have different people, but it all depends on you, how you take it. If they're asking, why don't you tell them that, look, I'm not comfortable. You go ahead or you stop them. It all depends on you. And yes, it definitely depends on the company, but at the end, it's you who are and your opinion or choices. So this is what I learned from my advisor.
Thanks so much. Thanks for sharing. I was just also wondering that what is it that the advisor does that helps you in your day-to-day, being in college as well? What is the role of an advisor? How has the advisor helped you over a period of time? Any of you can answer, yeah.
Any of you. So basically, as Sana said, the environment has changed a lot from a school to a college. A school where you're always supported by DDs and teachers, basically. And in college, there's no one to support. And when these feelings came in, there's a lot of fear you get in your heart. And they have, as Sana said, they have advisors. These are the advisors who have been to this position. They have been to colleges. And so they are the ones who are always inspiring us, motivating us. This is how you do it. This is how you can still do it. It's not something out of the this is not out of the box. This is something you can still try and get out of. So that's how the advisors help us. I'm going to talk more about it in the time ahead.
Sure. Thank you so much. Both of you.
You yourself.
I have two questions, which any of you can answer again. Is that which grades, I think which kind of board that you graduated from in school? Was it a CBSE? Was it a state
board? SSC board. The state board. Our schools are all state board.
There's a question by Elizabeth. She asked that RTE recommends that free and compulsory education must be given to students between the ages 6 and 14.
Yeah.
Does this not play a role in expanding the public education system in Pune beyond 7th grade?
No, 14 translates to grade 7 in or grade 8. Na? So most places it's either 7 or 8 depending on what you start. Pune government has interpreted that as grade 7. And precisely that's why they don't care. They're like, RTE is only asking till age 14, so chhodo uske baad kyun kiya jaye? And precisely uske wajah se funds bhi nahi aa rahe unke paas to be able to start those schools. That's one of the big barriers why they're not moving ahead. And until the RTE makes it 18 at least, I'm not seeing how they're going to get funds and the political will to start acting on this problem.
Guys, feel free to unmute yourself and ask questions directly to Soumya and the students as well who are here. Doesn't only have to be the chat
room.
Okay. Yeah. I have a question. Can I ask?
Yes, please.
The question is that it is as we are leading the students to college to employment. Okay, so we are supporting them as we are mentoring them when they are reaching to their college. We are giving them n number of support, motivation, and the, of course, guidance as the kid just shared.
Yeah.
To make the right choices in their life.
Yeah.
But now then further when they passion. Okay, it is only about the passion. If they follow, they will be getting the employment. How we are enrolling them to the employment? So do we have tie-ups with the corporates or the companies wherein they are getting?
So, yeah. So honestly, we haven't reached there yet, right? We are only 4 years old. Our eldest batch is just given the grade 12. So, and we're inventing a lot of this support as we are going along. So over the next 3 years, we'll figure out how do we equip them best going ahead. Our vision though is less to have tie-ups with corporates and stuff, but more to make sure that our students are so ready that when they graduate college, like there's no difference between when I graduated college and Mahesh graduates college. In fact, there's a big difference. Mahesh is far superior to me because he came from where he fought. I can't think about that. And so the whole point is that how do you get them as ready as possible before there? But surely in the next 2 years, if we feel like we need to develop some of these partnerships, we'll go around and develop some of these partnerships as well. But that's something like we have 2 years to figure that out.
Soumya, there's a question that Ankita was asking, that why have you just opted for state boards and not other boards as well? I was just telling her that first generation learners usually tend to be more in state boards than other boards. But again, you can clarify again that why concentration on state boards alone?
Yeah. So, Ekta, one request, I'll answer this one. But if you can take these cool wala questions na and put them towards the end, it'll make more sense. So we don't flip between alumni and school as much. Yeah. But to answer this question, no particular reason. Yeah. So what we do is 8th and 9th May, honestly, I give my teachers complete independence to teach whatever they want in whatever way is best. So for example, in grade 8 social studies, we adopted a lot of the CBSE textbook. In fact, I teach CBSE textbook because we found the CBSE textbook to be far superior. As far as science goes, we actually use a lot of the ICSE text because that is much better. The really simple answer is ki it was fastest to get state board permission. And so we wanted to start really quickly with that. But 8th and 9th May, my teachers have full independence to teach whatever curriculum they want. So in the sense that my, if you talk to some of my English teachers, right, and Mahesh and Sana can add some examples if you guys want to. But they've studied books like Wonder Girls, they studied books like Elon Musk's biography, they studied books like Mulgudi Days, and they studied books. And so they deleted half the textbook in English because they found much better text to go after and study. Same with social studies, actually, in grades 9, and the whole, in one entire unit, so one quarter of the year, they actually study current affairs, which is not so much a part of the text right now, but it's so important, especially elections happening and all the stuff that's happening in India. My social studies lead teachers developed a current affairs curriculum and they teach that. And so the text is a lewd guideline, SSE is a loose guideline, but we've ensured enough independence for our schools that 8th and 9th, we take the best of what is available in the market. Another example is a couple of our schools teach what is called the Big History Project, which is an outstanding project by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation that combines science and social studies into one subject for a year long, which teaches you all the most important things from Big Bang till 1985, I think, something like that. So it's just easiest to get permissions for state board. That's why we went there. But we pick and choose curriculum from all over.
Soumya, let's move ahead then.
Yeah. Cool. So these were the five big barriers that we found and then started designing our program around this. I will, of course, share this deck with you also so you can go through this in some more detail. Based on this research that we had, we prioritized these six key levers. And these are six bets, okay? Again, I'm being very honest here that we're only 2 years old. This wing is only 2 years old. So these are all bets that we have taken to say this is the best, this is for our best understanding, and we're very happy to evolve as we learn more. And I'll just breeze through these six, and then I'll get the kids take over, the students take over, dare I call them kids anymore, let them take over and describe some of the things that we are doing to translate these key levers into programs and projects. Yeah. The first one is a purpose and plan. So does every student know what is their five-year vision, and are they able to set smart goals towards getting there? It becomes very easy to get into the ocean of college and get lost into why am I there? Yeah. The second one is they have to focus on academics and show consistent growth if they're going to stick it through the next 5 years. The third one is this advisor, right? A positive support system, at least one trusting adult who they can reach out to at any time with any problem. That could be social, emotional, financial, mental, family problem, academic problem, anything. They have one mentor or one phone number to reach out to when they need to make key decisions. Fourth one is financial readiness. Start figuring out how are they going to pay their college fees. It could be figuring out what scholarships are available, which we connect them to a lot. It could be saving money. It could be doing a part-time job and saving money. Whatever needs to be done to make sure you're able to pay through college. The fifth one is more on the mindsets and values. So these are the three that we've identified as the most important values for our students. Ownership. So take ownership of your own learning. Grit. be prepared to fail every day for many months, but keep the long-term vision in mind and persistence towards a long-term goal and resourcefulness. Don't come and tell me ki mere college mein ye nahi hai, school mein to ye tha, mere teacher to padhata nahi hai, ye nahi tha, mere paas to tuition ke liye resources nahi hai, notes nahi hai. That's fine, man. Show resourcefulness and get that. These are the three values that we try and inculcate. And the last one is, don't get so lost ki mere ko exam crack karna hai, that you move away from a healthy and balanced lifestyle. And that could be in many ways. That could be through sports, that could be through your hobbies, it could be through music, it could be through many other ways, but encouraging this also. So these are six priorities that we have set for our students, and six bets saying if our students are focusing on these six things, they are likely to make it through college and achieve their personal vision. Yeah. I'm going to not wait for questions here because we're running short of time. I'm going to let the students take over and tell you how did we translate these priorities into programs and projects which are we actually implementing on the ground now. So I'm going to hand over to Mahesh now, who's going to talk about our core programs. Programs are things that we run. Programs are things that we run throughout the year. So this is what our staff does throughout the year. The second part is projects. Projects are either for some time or pilots that we are running. We're not entirely sure if they'll work or not, but things we're trying. And then Snehal will take over the last part, which is how is this all alumni driven right now. Yeah. Mahesh, if you want to quickly introduce yourself, tell us just a little bit of background also before you get started. Yeah.
Hi everyone. I'm Mahesh Janila and I'm studying in 11th. I've just completed my 11th grade and I'm studying arts. I'm from Don Bosco Junior College. That's about me. I'm going to just talk about the core program that iTeach Schools is doing for the alumni batch. We'll go ahead. Okay, so first one, through college advisor. Basically, as we talked before, that when your schools are always supported and there's always this positive supporting system. But then when you get out of school, there's no positive support system. There's different environment to get into, that we get into, and we are not aware of their environment. So we have advisors, the staff. There's always one RIA or VD for every college. And we meet every month where they help us with different stuff. For example, every month there's sessions which is actually planned to bring that motivation and inspiration back to have these college days well, study well. For example, I had environment. The environment was very different and I was suffering that I'm not getting what's being taught in college, teachers are not teaching well, and I was really worried. So I have my two college advisor whom I could go to, always talk to. I could talk about emotional pressures, family problems. There's always one person to go to. This is who a true college advisor is. And I would like Jaya to share a few examples.
I just want to share a couple of quick examples really quickly and then give it back to Mahesh. So one really strong example I think comes to mind is this student named Shivani. Yeah. So Shivani was in our school, in our first school. She finished her 10th standard. And then there was a lot of pressure for a home to not go to college. Her people were just not, her family was not keen for her to go to college. And so she didn't even join. And us time our student alumni wing hadn't really kicked in full force. And so we kind of missed that. Yeah. And she was sitting at home doing nothing. By the time December came about, our student alumni wing came together, kicked in saying, okay, who are the students who are not going to college? Why? Went after them. They talked to Shivani, talked to parents, figured this out and did two things. One, they got her a part-time job. Now, a strength of Shivani's was that she's actually an excellent communicator and reasonably fluent in English. Yeah. So her through college advisor helped her get a part-time job at Airtel, where I'm sure you guys have got pesky calls saying switch to Airtel, right? I know you guys don't like them. One of them is Shivani though. So next time somebody calls, don't judge them. Okay. She's doing this for a living and is doing a fantastic job at it. And so Jan, Feb, March, she did this for 3 months. And they also give damn good training, man. So she got training on how to give a good pitch. She got training on which are the kind of people to approach. And when I met her in March, it was phenomenal because she was telling me, bhaiya, my entire game is a scale game. And this is quote unquote from an 11th grade student who has not gone to college. Huh? Shivani is telling me it's a scale game. So what that means is, main 200 call karti hun roz ka. Usme se 20 interest dikhate hain, to shayad 2 convert hote hain. So mere ko 200 call to karna hi hai din ka, no matter what. And then she gave me a flow of what the pitch goes like, etc. She was doing so well that in April, they offered her the role of like a team lead type of thing. So she had 4 new people under her and she had to coach them, shadow their calls. This call may be recorded for quality monitoring purposes. Shivani right now at Airtel is actually doing that. But what's beautiful is the through college advisor helped her next year get into college. Now she is doing her, she just finished her 11th, is going into 12th with the Airtel job continuing in parallel. Now this is a key role of a student, of a through college advisor, saying ki ghar pe baith ke, she's literally sitting at home, doing nothing. And moving that, shifting that to part-time job, growing there, plus coming back to the college system and continuing ahead. This is one example, but I said dheer sare examples hain of college advisors being able to shift dropout cases. Another example would be a couple of our students now who finished grade 11 are not loving what they did, right? To hua kya, number high aa gaye unke 80-85%, to pahunch gaye science mein pahunch ke unko laga ki yaar Mahesh has raha hai piche, by the way, because he's one of them. Science mein kya laga ki yaar mujhe to maza aa raha tha arts karne mein, मैंने तो ये गलती ले ली, सबकी बात सुन ली बेकार में. तो नाउ द थ्रू कॉलेज एडवाइजर इज हेल्पिंग देम स्विच फ्रॉम साइंस टू आर्ट्स एंड ट्राइंग टू इवैल्यूएट व्हाट कॉलेजेस आर गुड फॉर देम एंड हाउ विल अलाइन टू देयर करियर ऑप्शंस एंड थिंग्स लाइक दैट. एंड ऑनेस्टली देयर इज नोबडी एल्स इन द वर्ल्ड हु कैन हेल्प देम विद दिस अपार्ट फ्रॉम देयर थ्रू कॉलेज एडवाइजर हु इज देयर फॉर देम हियर. कपल ऑफ अदर केसेस सम अदर डे वी कैन डिस्कस आर व्हेन स्टूडेंट्स इवन गॉट मैरिड. सो कपल ऑफ आवर स्टूडेंट्स गॉट मैरिड आफ्टर 10th. नथिंग वी कुड डू अबाउट इट, देयर वाज जस्ट टू मच प्रेशर फ्रॉम द फैमिलीज. And these people, these advisors are very intrusive people. So they're talking to the parents, talking to in-laws also, Jagruti thi. In-laws also convincing them, chalo aapne shaadi kar di, theek hai, but phir bhi college bhejo. So some of this stuff is what our TCA advisors do. Mahesh, sort of time, okay?
Soumya, sorry, just one question that's come up on the conversation that we just had right now. Who are these advisors again? I think you mentioned earlier, if you can reiterate that point again.
They're all staff members. So we have a 7-member full-time team. We hire, I think, 4 of them are from a social work background. We've hired social workers, essentially. 2 of them have been teachers in the past. One of them, Uma Bhaiya, who was a founding team member. He's also sitting here right now and feeling very happy to be here. He's the guy waving. So Uma Bhaiya was a teacher at one of our schools and then transitioned into the student alumni wing. And Tanvi, who leads it, was also a teacher with us who went on to found this wing. So these guys are advisors. They have about 50 to 60 students under them and try and do monthly meetings with all the students, sometimes in groups, sometimes weekly, sometimes over phone, different ways to reach all the students.
Also, in addition to how do you train these advisors, if somebody's asking?
Essay type question. Can I direct that to Tanvi, please? I wish I knew the answer to that. I really don't know kya karti hai unke saath, but they seem to be having fun doing it.
Great. So what I'll do is, when I'm sharing resources with all of you who've registered, I will also ask, I'll make Tanvi part of that thread and she can answer that question.
Fantastic. Okay, Mahesh, over to you. Move on to second one. Be brief.
And the second program is Certified Peer Learning Program. As we talked about, when you go out of schools, there's no proper academic that's been provided in colleges. At the same time, we get out of these values and the support that we used to get in school. So now, by this program, every Sunday, student alumni come back to their schools to study in their peer learning peer groups. So they are divided into their team-wise, like science team, arts, and commerce, so that they study and learn from their peers. And we have mentors who come from outside to mentor these groups. At the same time, the other purpose and impact is that when you come back to the school, when you see these walls full of charts, you get those feelings, those values come back in us and you say, okay, man, I can still do it. So two things, of course, academics at the same time, those values and those feelings come back. And third one is life skills opportunities. It's very important that we kids going into college and in a few years gonna look for employment. Life skills are too important, and IT schools provides us with too many opportunities, internships, volunteering, hobby-related opportunities, part-time jobs. So that at one hand we're learning, we're inculcating different skills. At the same time, in few part-time jobs, we're also earning. So if we have many examples, for example, we have Akash, who has joined Just for Kids, which is a football tournament. He coaches 6 football teams. Of course, he is earning at one hand, but at the same time, he's learning too many skills. He's leading the group. And we have too many examples. For example, we have Gauri, who has joined a non-profit organization where he teaches English to kids from slum areas. So there are numerous examples where kids, at one hand, are learning skills, at the same time, earning for their future. And now,
go ahead. You wanted to add something more to it? Go ahead.
So this is about co-programs that IT schools provide us. Now I'll give it over to my friend Sana. We'll talk about other programs.
Hello, my name is Sana. As I mentioned before, I am a grade 11 student in Don Bosco Junior College. My mom is a housewife, my father works in the construction site, and I'm studying arts. Like Mahesh talked about programs which run through the year, I'm going to talk about projects that happen between the years. So there are 5 projects I'll be talking about, the first and foremost being college admission support. So this was really needed because in the start when you're going to college, how do you know what college to take? I remember Bhaiya coming, the sorting members, them coming and taking a meeting with my parents and making us write a list of 10 colleges. Now why 10 colleges? You can just pick up one and just be there in that college. Now those 10 colleges were divided into first 2 college, which is your dream college. So for me, it was Ferguson and Symbiosis. Then you have to write 3 colleges which are in your reach that you can get through by one or second round. And the last was 5 colleges which are safe in your hands, you can go. So this is how, because my parents could not tell me because they haven't gone to colleges, they could not tell me which college is best for you, but having somebody who would decide which college is best for you and you can reach was done through college admission support. The other project that was there was financial readiness. Definitely everything was done, college is there, your percentages are there, but how do you get in? Financial support, right? Now parents did not know because they have been sending them to a free school. They did not know how much money is required or something. Plus getting that money, 15,000 or 20,000 on average, was difficult in some months, right? So 2 opportunities granted by iTeach was 1 scholarship. Having 70%+ would give you a scholarship. For example, I got Cybase scholarship and my whole year's fees was paid by them because I got 77.6%. So this was one of the ways I paid my college fees. The other way was doing part-time jobs during the months of holidays. So financial readiness was there. We'll move on to the second one, the third one actually, Lean-In. This is my favorite. Like Maya said, coming back to CPLP, where academic related things were happening, coming back to school, learning values. For me, my happiness during these days were, so this Lean-In sessions are held for girls, where they come back and they discuss what all problems they had or what all change they want to bring about. We have this session once, twice in a week. And we, for this year, our goal was to talk about job versus career. What is exactly the difference between job and career? And we did talk about many things. One of the major examples I would like to share about was Renuka. Like Mahesh mentioned, too many people are doing part-time jobs, but then they need family support, right? Because the family needs to trust them. Renuka was one of them who wanted to do everything, football, job, studies and everything. But then her family didn't support because they did not trust her. And because of relative influences, she was asked to come back. But then having lenient session where she actually trusted the circle around and she shared it. And then we could actually solve her problem out by telling how too many things if you do, definitely you're going to get struggled. Let's keep doing one thing. And then how it got translated and now she's balancing her life properly. So lenient helps in that. The next one is career fairs. I would like to combine this and the other one, which is career fairs and alumni reunion together, because it's the same thing. Where once a year, everyone comes together and make sure that they remind each other. So there are four different schools right now which come together across 40 different colleges. And it's important for them to come back because they're learning at different colleges. One from Ferguson, then one from Coed, then one from various different colleges. And it's important to share what you have learned because different environment, different notes, different boards maybe. So coming back together and learning this from each other really influences because experience matters. So one is this, the other thing is career fairs, which I talked about. We have gone to college, but we are not sure what do we really want to become. Giving a clear idea what do you really want to become, you need to talk to a person who has done it. So during this career fairs, we have different places where these people go, like a room where different leaders are kept. Leaders like somebody from an engineer, somebody who has done engineering, a doctor, maybe a journalist, and they explain how their career was so that these people actually know, look, it's not only going up on the TV and speaking, but many things behind it also. So having career fairs and alumni reunions where people from 40 different colleges come together and learn about it. Okay, all of these 9 projects, I'm sure you'll be wondering who does it all. So for answering that question, I'd like to call Snehal who would do it.
Hello everybody. My name is Snehal and I'm one of the leaders. I'm part of the leadership council. So this alumni leadership council is actually a part of SWAT team, meaning we are 15 alumni selected who would work with SWAT team to make sure all these projects and programs which Mahesh and Sana talked about, all this come into picture. Now when I talk about all these things, firstly, when we all 15 were selected, we all were from 4 different schools. And it was difficult to make sure that we trust each other, we have that bond so that we can work together. Like we were going to work upon all these programs. So it was important that we build that culture and all this culture, learnings, values, and our vision which we'll be working upon was discussed in the beginning of the year. And we were the ones making sure throughout the year that the CPLP is happening, like certified peer learning program happens, lean-in takes place, then through college advisory project is going properly. So let's get in deeper. Like I would like to talk about our own roles. Like when I talk about CPLP, I mean in that we leaders are supposed to go to our school an hour before, making sure there we go, we set up the classrooms, agenda is ready on the board, and plus a day before we need to make sure opening activity is reviewed by one of the teachers, which would not only give laughters to people and have fun, but also make sure, as Mahesh said, we make sure that we go through our values and all. So the activity is mostly valuable, like something to learn from. That's one thing. And last thing is that, why would people would like to come to on Sunday to school, that too for studies and like not much fun. So we make sure that ALC, make sure that attendance is happening. We make sure people come. We are the ones driving the whole attendance part, making sure those who are already coming, they're coming regularly. Plus, jo nahi aa rahe, how are we making sure these people as well come and what interesting stuff we can have. Second program I would move on would be reunions, which Sana as well talked about, I guess. Reunion is like, I agree, people come together and all. But what do we do after coming together? The whole agenda, which activity will be done when? Who will be the panel speakers? What content will be discussed? Will it be what, like in the opening, will it be ownership stories and helpless stories or some other topic? Everything is discussed by all 15 leaders and the SOAR team. SOAR team is not just 15 of us, but it's also the 6 teachers who are part of it. We are guided by them. We have monthly meetings in which we are we plan for our upcoming projects and stuff like that. In reunion, we do come together. We are divided into different groups. We brainstorm different various ideas, making sure which activity would our friends like, which one they might not, and all those things. And at the end, we make sure we come with the best of the agendas, and our friends leave the place with a learning takeaways, and they do have fun meeting their friends. Coming to the third thing, it is through college advisory. We mentioned that we have through college advisory program where students are assigned with one advisor. Now we have monthly advisories with this advisor who talks about our how our studies going, what support do we need, then what are the things which will be coming up, like internships and all are discussed there, of course. But then the guidance part, but how much efforts are required to be at the best level, all those things are happening. But there are some students who are not interested. I mean, they're not interested. So just to make sure that advisors are able to reach those students who need it the most, we leaders help them out in reaching out, as we are in the same college, and it gets easier to interact with friends than with teachers. That's right. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's really nice. I've been getting a lot of responses in the chat window as well. People are really inspired with the stories that you've shared and the continued effort you are taking to continue through college. So it's very inspiring. Thank you for sharing all the time. Soumya, would you like to add anything before we open to question and answers?
That's really it. I just wanted to close out with going back to the vision a little bit, right? And hopefully you're seeing some of these things come alive. So like I stressed, even when we went through the vision, alumni driven community of support, and that's kind of our big deal. So what Snehal just mentioned, and I wanted to just reiterate that we'd like the alumni to lead as much of the work as possible over time. I think the first iteration was, as is usual with any kind of work, the first iteration was them doing a little bit. These guys are our second batch. They're very much a part of the SOAR team. And so they were working a lot on that, leading a lot of parts of it. And we want to see where this goes in the next 2-3 years and how much of it could continue being alumni driven. I'm happy to take questions around anything from the programs that we are running, different programs. I'll leave this slide on because this actually captures the barriers and then most of the programs that we are running. Happy if you guys want to ask any questions to these guys, school related, their background, how are they here, anything that makes sense. Thank you very much, guys, for attending this webinar. Ekta will share email addresses and all of that for questions. Ekta, I'm actually going to share out these guys' email address also. If you want to write to one of these three directly, please feel free to write to them directly as well, and they'll get back to you with what their thoughts are. But yeah, thank you very much, guys. I leave this slide on, and let's go with Q&A.
Sure. There's a question by Sangeeta, who's asking that are there modules that you've developed on sex education, orientation, and bullying as well?
Is there a module we developed on it, you're saying?
Yes.
We partnered with an organization called RICE. No, the organization is called School of Life. It's based in Delhi. And they have an entire 6-month program called RICE, which is Relationship, Intimacy, and Sexuality Education. So they actually trained 2 teachers in every school, and they delivered it as part of the curriculum. So about an hour a week or maybe 2 hours a week. I'd have to check with the school leaders. But we do. And that happens, I think, at the end of grade 9.
I'm guessing also people want to know if these modules are available for other people who are working with students. Can they also access some of these?
Some of them we can share freely, stuff that's open source. But some of this stuff like RICE, I'd have to ask School of Life if it's open source or not. What I can definitely do is connect you to our program partners, wherever it is not. All of our material, 100%. I'm so happy to share everything that we have. But stuff that we have through partners, such as this RICE thing, I can connect you to them and you can see if they're willing to share it. Because some of them are for-profit organizations that might have IP issues, but anything that's ours, happy to email as many people as possible.
Thank you so much.
Can I go in?
Yeah, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Soumya, I just wanted to know this whole mentorship, like I can see how strong a role your mentors play or advisors play. So it's just those 7 people who you said that are distributed across the 60 kids. So 60 kids from year 1 and 60 from year 2, is that how it is?
No, it's actually 50 total right now. So we have 350 alum. So 750 is about 350. Okay. Yeah.
So one person like caters to needs of like 50 kids and meets them once a month at least. And they're all working with your organization only. You don't take mentors from outsiders.
So the weekly study sessions that they have, the certified peer learning program, usme there are a bunch of people who come and help with academics. I mean, their actual role is to help with academics, but often those guys will also end up being mentors for our students. So many of them have continued to come every Sunday for the last 2 years now, and they've got to know the students. And so they're also another set of mentors. But something we do want to expand is to start moving towards a mentorship program, which is potentially roping in more volunteers. And we're actually reaching out to Mentor Me India and a couple of other organizations to see what they have learned and if we want to move towards there also. Right now, we've kept it all in-house with our staff. Because the first time we're doing it, right, we wanted to learn as much as possible, as quickly as possible. So we've kept it in-house with all our staff right now.
Also, there was a question that is it a one student, one mentor program, or how many students does an advisor have?
50 is to one. So an advisor has 50 students assigned to them. The way they go about it mostly is they classify the students into need levels. So a high need, medium need, and a low need student. And so a low need student, they might just make a group of say 15 of them who go to colleges nearby and meet them once a month for like 2-3 hours and generally get an update and guide them through it. And that's enough. Somebody with a medium need, they might meet once every 2 weeks or so. And somebody with a high need, they might do a one-on-one call almost every week. So that's kind of how they're going about it now.
Yeah, thanks a lot. There's a question on the curriculum that came earlier as well, was that you have so many things going and there is so much more that you can do. So in the sense, how do you take decisions in terms of, you know, this is what my focus is, or this is as an organization our focus is for this year or this month, and then we move on to another thing. Is it just research-based, or is it also the needs that students themselves have and they work?
So in 2015, we started with saying ki our 10th cross to karao pehla, and that was kind of the bread and butter. That was the first proof point. In 2017, once that happened, we set 2020 proof points, and these are the 4 big focus areas we want to go after. And we created our first student vision, and everything is now driven through that student vision. So our 4-point student vision is really simple, actually. Every student who graduates from iTeach will A, go to and through college, B, lead a healthy and balanced lifestyle, C, be aware of their passions, strengths, and career opportunities, and D, own India's development in their own way. And so everything that comes out, everything that we do is guided by the student vision and saying how can we best achieve this for every student possible. And so through the year, as we go out, as we try, our school leaders innovate, come up with different programs, which we replicate. We have a curriculum team. So we had one person so far. Now we're expanding to a 3-member curriculum team this coming year. They'll keep improving things as we go along. We're a very iterative kind of company, or iterative kind of organization. So what we did in our first year, we'll improve it in certain areas into year 2, into year 3, and so on. And so it's a mix of, strategy is always an art and a science, you know? So it's a mix of, what do we do well and we want to keep doing? What are our students telling us they need? And our student alumni even telling us, ki yaar, agar ye aap school mein karoge, then it will be even better. So an example, one of the things that came out a lot from our student alumni was that they're not nearly as equipped with technology as they should be. And so now our schools this coming year will have a big focus on tech to make sure they're walking out very tech friendly, you know? just a combination of what our students are telling us. And the third thing is, what are people in the world doing? So 7 members of our leadership team right now are in the US visiting some of the best schools in New York, whether it's KIPP and whether it's some of the high income schools there as well, learning from them and then bringing that back in the next couple of months to feed it into our school design. So I guess 3 kind of questions, if I want to summarize, right? Inside out question, what do you do well and you want to continue doing? Outside in question, what are our stakeholders saying we need? And far outside in, what are the people in the world doing that we want to go after?
Sure, thank you. There's a question for Mahesh.
Questions.
Yeah.
Who is this?
This is Ruchita.
Ruchita, go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Soumya. I just have a question. You did your fellowship in Eat for India in 2013, right?
Yes.
Again, in 2015, you said that you started iTeach.
Yes.
So when did you realize during your fellowship, when did you get the thought that you need to start this, and what were the challenges really? And how did the 17, core members you have, you help them join together and started this? And we know.
Wow. Essay type question, okay? All 3 of them. But okay, I'll go through it really quickly, okay? So, honestly, within the first 6 months of joining the fellowship, something that I realized was that schools, and especially low-income schools, are just run really poorly. So let's forget about the teachers there. Let's forget about the money and all of that. But even without changing any teachers or without changing any of the core things such as the fees or government rules and all, the schools could just be run much better. So I always felt within 6 months, if my principal was to go on a year and a half sabbatical and tell me ki Soumya tu school ko chala der saal, without changing anything fundamental, just by being a better manager, I could get the school outcomes to double. This sounds arrogant, but that's what I felt, okay, at that time. So I felt that a lot, saying that basic things that corporates do well, if schools were to introduce, they could be run much better. And so I'll give you 3-4 examples. Number one, why isn't there a career path in education even today? Koi bhi corporate mein, you start at an associate level, you go to a manager, you go to a senior manager, etc., etc., you wind up as a partner. A teacher starts as a teacher, stays as a teacher for 20 years, jo usme sabse senior hota hai, usko principal bana dete hain. This is such a hogwash kind of management, you know. So the one thing that we've done at iTeach is we have a clear career path saying you join an associate teacher. If you do really well, you move to senior teacher, you move to lead teacher, you move to assistant school leader, you move to school leader. We've upended the entire experience thing. We've thrown out the experience thing and made it a pure meritocracy. Jo sabse achcha outcome leke aayega, uska promotion hoga, aage badhega, which is how the rest of the world works, except for school education system. We're among the few to try performance-based pay. So if our teachers drive higher outcomes, there's a component in their annual performance appraisal where they get a higher pay if they're driving better outcomes right now. And not just our schools, everyone across the org. Yeah. Timetabling, resource allocation, hiring better, putting effort into recruitment. Yeah. Last year, we interviewed 620 people to select our 18 teacher openings that we had last year. Because it's not easy to get a good teacher who can move students from low-income schools and from the families that they're coming into to the level that these 3 are speaking right now. These 3 fascinate me, right? Because ye log jahan hain is far beyond where I was. Ye log jo baatein kar rahe hain abhi, ki we will lead our alumni through college. Nobody else in the world is doing today, you know, in grade 11. And so, but it takes a really special group of teachers to be able to achieve that. And so investing in recruitment. So we have a 3-member recruitment team that does that. So my point of this is that during my fellowship, 6 to 8 months in, I realized that there needs to be a lot of just run a better organization, school as an organization, which will shift things more than the pedagogy and things. Wo to improve ho nahi hai, but run a better org first. So that's kind of one. And so I was aching to be school leader, honestly, by the time I graduated, saying, yaar, please mujhe control do ek school chalane ka. I was aching to do that. And so I matched that to the opportunity ki har crisis mein opportunity hoti hai na. So there was a crisis of this secondary school nahi hai. I saw it as an opportunity in which Shweta Sarkar, another 2013 Teach for India alum, both of us said that, yaar, let's take this problem head on and go after it and start 2 schools and see where it goes. So that's to answer your first question, how I realized that. How did we get this leadership team together? go watch Avengers, okay? Avengers movies mein, jis tarike se Nick Fury goes and gets Iron Man and Hulk and all these people together. Whenever I watch the Avengers, I have never aspired to be Iron Man or Thor or Black Widow or any of those guys. I have always aspired to be Nick Fury. Ki how to get these people together. And so, saam, daam, dand, bhed, kuch bhi karke, the most important thing that a leader can do is bring the best possible team together. And so I've invested a lot of time in that. Sometimes from figuring out who are the best graduating fellows and buying them expensive dinners and then convincing them to come join me, to sometimes harassing people till they join me. I don't know. I mean, there are many ways to hire, yeah, but basically you have to put intentional effort into it. And that's kind of how we go up. I'll give you one story, right, of this guy who's sitting here. Isko turn karo, Uma bhai, aap screen pe dalo. So, hamara jab pehla school shuru hua, right? So, dheere dheere us community mein kuch kuch baat phaili ki yaar kuch to interesting ho raha hai yahan. I don't think the community believed ki ye kuch bahut acha karenge, but kuch to interesting ho raha hai. 8 ghanta chalta hai ye school, uske baad volleyball classes hoti hai aur ghar hi aate students ko aur inka principal sirf 30 saal ka hai, to kuch na kuch interesting ho raha hai. They started realizing in the community. So, dheere dheere ye urti urti khabar Uma Shankar ke paas pahunchi hai. Uma Shankar yahan jo samne baithe hain, Uma Shankar walked in one day to the school and came and told me ki Soumya, I have always dreamed to be a teacher, but I never found a good school to teach in. So I quit my aspirations and moved to a call center, and I work in a call center for the past 4-5 years, right? And mujhe yahan aake kuch aisa feel aa raha hai ki I really want to come back to teaching. Koi banda yaar ye aake keh raha hai mere se, honestly, we interviewed him. Wo interview farce tha. I knew I was going to hire him the minute he had given me this 1 minute spiel. We hired him. The guy came on. He taught social studies for a year. He didn't enjoy it as much, honestly. But his relationship building with students was fantastic. He moved to student alumni wing and is killing it with students right now in the last 2 years as an advisor. A lot of the stories that I'm sharing are Uma Shankar's stories right now, right? So, aise dheere dheere log badhte jate hain, judte jate hain. And that's any startup, yeah. Basically, any startup you feel is like the key is hiring. And so that's kind of how we went about hiring for it. My long-term hiring plan is, of course, these guys, yeah, by the way. कि जब ये कॉलेज खत्म करेंगे तो माय एक्सपेक्टेशन इज कि महेश कम्स एंड जॉइन्स आईटीच. दिस इज अ नोन एक्सपेक्टेशन फ्रॉम डे वन सिंस ही हैज कम इन.
समय लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस कमिंग इन.
गो फॉर इट प्लीज. आई वांट टू स्टॉप. यस,
नो, इट्स ग्रेट टू नो एज वेल, बट या आई थिंक अदर क्वेश्चंस.
प्लीज.
आई थिंक देयर वाज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम सागरिका हु वाज आस्किंग दैट किड्स हु कम फ्रॉम रियलिटीज दैट यू वर्क विद, दिस अल्टरनेटिव एजुकेशन पोस्ट 10th इज सजेस्टेड फॉर सच चिल्ड्रन. Also, this is keeping in mind the employability aspect. Example schools like Shulai and Kodaikanal, barefoot college, barefoot school, headfoot school, so things like these.
I'm sorry, what is the question?
The question is you know, alternative education post-10 for students who come from realities that you've been speaking about, does it make sense keeping in mind the employability aspect of this?
We are still evolving, and our first step was to close the gap between these students and middle income and high income students. So we set the same targets and same goals. We're realizing a lot of this right now, and our team is doing research into it right now to figure out if it makes sense. But I don't have a good answer for this. Honestly, we are very much in the initial phase where we started with saying, pehle jo middle income students kar rahe hain, usko to match karte hain. Yeah, so I don't know much about it, but these guys will know more in the coming years.
Sure. Rajesh has a question that, do you have any internship program for a short time, like on summer vacation of school, so that you can invest on fellows outside IT as well?
Multiple of them. I don't think we've done a very good job of advertising this stuff, but we'd love to have interns come in summer and work with either student alumni wing or any of our schools as well. Just send me an email. Ekta, just share my email address also when you do it. Yeah, just send me an email about any interest to work with the org.
Makes sense. Mahesh, Sana and Snehal, I think you guys were sharing your experiences earlier, and there was a question that, how do you manage to study and work at the same time? Because as adults, I think it's still a daunting thought And also it's difficult to think about how do you manage both. So how do you guys manage and help us understand more? Also, the case study that you shared, is there a place that you've compiled all these case studies for others to even listen and, you know, learn from it? Have you documented them somewhere in terms of your experience?
Which case study?
So I think what people are looking at are students' experiences as case studies. And also, have they documented the experiences somewhere online or, you know, just written material? Because people are curious in terms of how students are managing going through college as well, with the support that they're getting.
I don't know if we've documented student stories as much. I think it's something we should do. Let me just check with Tanvi a little bit on how have they documented a lot of this stuff. I mean, they have systems to document every student and track their progress, but I don't know if it's in a form that anybody except Uma Shankar will understand right now. So let me just ask them. Yeah, it's a good question. I'll get back to you on this.
Sure, makes sense. I think you guys can answer the earlier question. Go ahead.
Answering to how we manage our studies and working at the same time is that it has been 12 years we have been in school. It has 3 years, of course, I teach, but then school has given us so much that we feel always free to be there for school, and that's what passionates us, meeting our teachers, working with them and doing something, adding value to school and us at the same time makes us more confident and, I mean, skilled at the same time. Adding up.
Yeah, I would like to add what Sneha said. I, of course, go to college. At the same time, I have a group which I lead with some of my friends, which is Uma, where we do some street plays on the social causes in the crowded places in the city. How do I manage? Is in these 3 years that I've spent in iTeach schools, I've been trained. I don't know how to explain it, but I have been trained that now when I think of so many things on my plate, I feel it more happy that I have more things and I can enjoy it. Rather than thinking that I'm gonna be very busy, it's gonna be tiring. I feel more happy, and that's what been created by my teachers back in iTeach school.
So I think it's more of a tacit knowledge than put it that way. Difficult to put it in words. But thank you so much for sharing. As Soumya is saying, I think it'd be interesting to also read a lot of the reflections that you probably are writing, or the documented reflections of your experience as well for others. So look forward to hear more of your experiences as well. Thank you for sharing.
I just had to ask one more question.
Pranati, can you wait for like 2 minutes because the others waiting in line? I'm really sorry.
Okay, yeah. No, it's already on the chat, so I was just going to ask, not my question, Kushar's question.
Yeah, so we'll just take it up in a second. Yeah. Thanks. There's a question I think that was asked initially that, you know, what people who join in here who are not really working in the school system, they really want to know how they can help first generation learners. What are the things that they can do that can help students?
I think, so are you asking more in terms of volunteering and stuff, Ekta?
I'm guessing, yeah, volunteering for sure, but I think all of us come across first generation learners, you know, somewhere or the other, like, you know, as you said, somebody's calling you over the phone, you don't really know where the background is. I think just generally that what can you do to support students? One is actively volunteering, but what else? Like,
I mean, I think it's a difficult question to answer because there are so many things you could do. One, come and join us, number one. write to me if you're interested. I have from 15 open positions to fill in the next month. But I think in terms of, I would say the number one thing to start doing is advocacy and learning and knowing more, you know. The students who come to us in grade 8 from PMC schools come in at grade level of 3. So typically 4 to 5 years behind, 4 to 5 years behind where they need to be compared to other middle income students. So ye bahut bada problem hai yaar. You can't have students reach grade 8 without being able to read a grade 3 and grade 4 textbook. Visit some of the government schools in your area and see what's happening. And then I feel like advocacy around that, saying why does there's a line that we use often, right? in India today, poverty is dictating destiny, and we are not okay with that. And so if you can start putting out as much knowledge, information, putting out advocacy around that, saying ki it's not okay that a student, unless they can shell out 50,000 a year, doesn't get a good education, that's just not okay. I feel like advocacy, volunteering, and then actively joining, contributing to some of the financially also would be 3-4 different ways of trying to address that, you know.
Yeah, but main thing is come and join
me. Right? Main thing to wohi hai, huh?
Okay, Praniti, go ahead, ask your question.
It's the same question that Kushali has put up. Soumya, like you guys start from grade 8. How do you all bridge that, the grade gap to grade? How do you all manage to do that? Is it just purely by like the kind of teachers you all are hiring? Like, I mean, I sort of got that answer from when you spoke about Umashankar. Is there like a specific program, especially with respect to reading, you know, because once they get reading, they can do something
else. Correct.
Ali has also asked, and that was one of my biggest questions that I wanted to ask you guys.
Yeah. So I think there's a combination of tough. That is by far our biggest challenge, right? Is covering that achievement gap up. I think one is the kind of teachers we hire. Usme bhi the literacy teachers we hire are typically the best people we can find. Second is the amount of time. So we'll give them almost 8 to 9 hours every week. So 2 hours a day of literacy instruction. So reading, writing, speaking and listening and grammar. So just the amount of time. Thirdly, programs such as choice reading. So we'll encourage them to read a lot of books when they go back home. We'll give them the books to take home and practice that. I think fourth is teaching at different levels. So in the sense that we have a lot of differentiated instruction. So in a class, typically a literacy teacher will have 3 lesson plans running in parallel. So they'll do something for the students at grade level 3 and 4, then some at 5 and 6, and then some at 7 and 8. So that also helps moving ahead instead of teaching everyone the same content. And then I think also, I think the fifth one maybe, how do you use science, social studies, mathematics even to continue building literacy skills? I mean, every teacher, so building this mindset in all our schools that every teacher is also a literacy teacher. So I think all of this put together helps in getting there. I'll also be honest with you, Praniti, that these three are the ones who have grabbed everything in school and progressed the fastest or among the fastest, right? Not every student is graduating with this level of fluency, self-awareness, or even desire with time. So I would say these three are probably representative of our top quartile students, or maybe top 40%, I would say. But we're still having many students who are graduating with still vast learning gaps, even when they're in college right now. But that's kind of the hope is some of these 4 or 5 things to go there. Yeah, I mean, if you thought on Akanksha, you know what's happening, you know? Yeah.
Okay, so that's, I think, the last question. We can't take any more questions because we've already 3 minutes over time. But thanks, Soumya, for doing this. And thank you, Mahesh, Sana, and Snehal as well for being here, as well as Uma, for, you know, being part of the experience and also helping us understand more of you. Good luck to all of you, and hope to hear more of your experiences in any medium possible.
Nikta, can you let the meeting run for a bit? I just want to run through the chat once myself, yeah?
Please go ahead, yeah.
Okay, thank you everyone. Thanks Ekta for the opportunity. My email address is there, guys. Happy to please email me. Any questions, thoughts, comments that you guys might have. I will also type out these three. I'll actually type out one of them. Mahesh, tumhara kya email address hai?
Mahesh.jh.
Check karo, am I typing it right?
Yeah.
So you can reach out to Mahesh and these guys directly as well as to me. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. I'm just going to go through this chat for a second. But yeah.
Soumya, I can share the chat as well because it's recorded in the thing. But yeah, I'll keep it running for 10 minutes.
Yeah, just give me like one minute. Yeah. I feel like I should almost keep the questions going. What are you going to do, Ekta? Not call me the next time?
Questions going in the sense?
मैं कह रहा हूँ जब इतने सारे 19 पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैं ऑनलाइन तो उनको पूछने दो ना व्हाट आर यू गोना डू व्हाट्स गोना बी द कॉन्सिक्वेंस यू वांट कॉल मी नेक्स्ट टाइम
I think we, yeah, I mean, the point is that they can keep asking, but then I have to also sit here and moderate it.
I know.
So that's the point here.
Okay, I have the chat. That's fine. Yeah. Cool.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, guys. Bye.